Hello, everyone. We are gonna talk a little bit today about music. We all love music. That's what we agreed on before we started coming up here. We all love music. And the panel is called The Future of Music is Social. Whatever this means, we will see where we end. Maybe we're gonna talk about beer in the end. We don't know yet. But first, let's start the discussion talking about recommendation systems. So how was it back in the days? Back in the days, we had radio or we had music magazines. The problem with music magazines was you really need to know the journalist to know what he was writing about, because reading about music is like dancing to architecture, you know? So you really need to buy some records or listen to some records which was very positive in the review, but then you will find out, oh no, it's definitely not my taste. So this journalist is not my taste. But now everything has changed. We don't need to trust on journalists anymore. Every one of us could be a recommendation engine. So, let me introduce the guests on my panel. Actually, I'm really proud about everyone here because it's a really great, and thanks to Jana, who put it together. We're gonna give her an applause later on when she's back. So, let's start with Dr. Professor Karl-Heinz Brandenburg. So for maybe some of you, you don't know, you are not aware of what he did. He has been a driving force behind some of today's most innovative digital audio technology, notably the MP3 and the MPEG audio standards. Then we go on. It's on the other side. Damn it. Oh, what's going on here? Sorry.
I mean, I can say who I am too, you know?
Oh, actually, that's perfect. Let's do it like
this microphone in my hand. I'm Peter Kern, and I am maybe the least technical of the four people here, or the one kind of odd man out in some ways. I mean, I'm a musician and a music technology journalist. So in that sense, in the sense of being a human journalist, I represent the old guard, or kind of the magazine. The magazine is online. Sometimes I write for print, but I still represent this non-algorithmic selection system in my head. Yeah. Okay. And I make synthesizers as well, so I make instruments.
Yeah, hi. My name is Stefan Baumann. I represent, two different guys. I'm a very technical guy from a professional perspective. We build still recommender systems. This is our daily job where we make the money from. But as a private person, I'm a musician, I'm a music lover, I'm a complete freak about music and very analog. So this is maybe a bit tough for you to follow. Maybe I will say when I'm professional and when I'm a private guy, because sometimes there's a big tension between the things I did on a professional base and which I use as a private person.
My name is Ben Fields, and I finished a PhD about a year ago in automatic playlist generation. So my sort of, can everybody hear me? Is that a little bit? How about just eat it? Yeah, is it, if I eat the microphone, is it okay? All right. So my name is Ben Fields, and I, about a year ago, finished up a PhD that was in playlist generation. So my sort of research interests are generally in using social information to make recommendations, things like this. And then since then, I've been working for a company that is called Music Metric, and we concern ourselves with everything that goes on the internet about music, and then sort of make it pretty and sell it back to the music industry. So this means that what I'm most sort of interested in is sort of sociocultural behavior around and concerning music, and being able to turn that into information that can make things more interesting somehow, and that can take lots of forms. I also, like everyone else on the panel, I'm a DJ in my free time. I don't know. I mean, it's a theme, I guess. Yeah, I think so. And if we start talking about beer, it's probably my fault. So, I'll leave it there.
Okay, and since that I helped develop MP3 more than 20 years ago, or around 20 years ago, is not so interesting for the time today. I'm nowadays director of one of the 60 Fraunhofer Institutes in Germany, and the Institute for Digital Media Technologies. We do a lot of work on music in all different kinds of way. Music analysis, so we are the ones who use machine learning and all these techniques to do recommendation, to do transcription of music, to help people play music with new games, who do use many loudspeakers to get a better sound than we have here, and so on.
Yeah, sorry for the sound, but it's, yeah, you know, it's the old airport, and but we will manage this, guys, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, let's talk about recommendation systems, human versus machine. So, actually, I am a digger, I love music, and I'm not really into... So, actually, there are not really good automated recommendation systems. There is, for example, no good Spotify app which shows me every Friday, because of my listening history, the new releases. So what I do is I dig every day blogs and SoundCloud and whatever to find music. How are you doing it?
Yeah, I mean, it's your very subjective personal experience. And if we talk about the user, we are talking about millions of different people having a completely different musical experience background. And this makes it sometimes a little bit hard for the algorithms, especially if you talk about the DJs, about the people digging deep into it. But you have to accept there are millions of people who tell me, not me personally, but the companies we are working with, come on, there is so much good music around. But if I open up my Spotify, Simfy, etc. account, I don't know what I should listen to.
Really?
And these mainstream, excuse me for that, these mainstream people indeed want some recommendation. And in these large amounts, we are talking about 15 million songs you have in an online streaming service, it's not possible for the company on a profit base to do manual checking of these things. And in this way, a automated algorithm can help mainstream people a lot to find a starting point, even that it is not perfect for music experts.
Okay, so I think that the mainstream people, they are buying charts music anyway. So they go to the store or they buy music which they heard on the TV. And this is going to be the charts music then?
No.
Good.
This was informed.
If we would have been all in one opinion, then it would be boring. So, go on.
This was in former days. But I mean, we are here talking about the future, maybe the midterm development. And the point is, people are streaming for like $5 a month. And they want to have access to 10 million songs, the entire catalog. And they don't go and buy CDs, or they don't listen to pop stars' formats and etc. No, they have the stuff on their mobile phone and they want to listen and they have no clue. I don't know why, because for me it's really like, what? You don't know what you should listen to? There is much more good new music around than I could ever listen to. And we are talking about these things of music experience, online streaming, large scale, the entire catalog.
Yes.
So going back to your sort of original premise that the reason, so you sort of put it out that you were digging because there wasn't a sort of machine version to do that for you. And I kind of, just to push back a little, wonder if if it's the digging that's giving you enjoyment as much as actually listening to the music. So I mean, I think there's a place for automatic systems to make that digging a better experience, but not to replicate it in its entirety. So I think there's a certain sort of set of people, we call them sort of, I don't know, but they're very active in their music selection process as much as their music listening process. And that act of selection is meaningful somehow, right? And so you don't want to take that away, you want to enable it with technology. So, I mean, there is simply too much music for you to listen to all of it. So perhaps you can envision algorithms in the sort of short-term future that are better at pushing you in a sensible direction, at showing you the blogs to get ideas for, but not to completely remove the act of digging for music, right? Because lots of people like to, you know, sit there and pick through the sort of digital bins, finding new music to listen to, right? So, I don't know, I think it's about, I mean, a good music recommender is as much about finding the right question to answer with a bit of software, as it is about solving that, or about answering that question well, right?
Yes, this is, yeah.
Yeah. In fact, I'm one of the people who needs help. When I was a teenager, I remember I walked, when I had enough money to buy some record, I walked into the record store and nearly always came out with something which I later on didn't like.
Oh.
So that didn't work out.
Did
not like, no.
Interesting.
So that paradigm didn't work somehow.
How did
so,
this happen?
Good question. I'm still not understanding it why, but anyway, most of the music I liked was somewhere on my tapes, tape machines recording from radio. That
yeah.
was the old time.
Yeah.
And later on, I think it's now nearly 15 years ago, my dream was always I want to come home and tell my home stereo by voice command, look, I'm tired, please play me some nice music.
Ah, if, okay.
And something which fits my mood of this time, not too fast, and by the way, nothing I listened to in the last 2 weeks, because that would be boring. Technically, we could do a lot of it, still somehow it's not there.
Really?
We can do a lot of things which get there, and in fact, it's not just Spotify and all these, it's my own music collection with a few thousand songs. On my MP3 player, I always get to the same records again, and I know there are others, but I don't, somehow it's not organized the right way. So I think something like recommendation, playlist generation, and so on is necessary. Second, it needs to be a combination of collaborative filtering, of others helping me to find something, and the computer helping with this, because that can do a lot of things already and makes it easier not to get to the same things again.
Yeah, but sometimes it's nice to have the same things again, you know, because you can sing along, for example.
Right, but what you're saying is
that the perception of this is the way to deal with the whole of all music creation. But some of us have even amassed an amount of music that we've listened to that we need some intelligent way of doing something other than just random shuffle mode with our own collection. You can't hire a DJ to play through your own collection. Unless you're in Berlin, which you probably can, actually.
In fact, let me do one test here. Who of you has more than 1 terabyte of music? There are legal ways to do it. Okay. So nobody has to. And a terabyte of music is, depending on the bitrate, up to years of uninterrupted listening. So I tend to say you don't have really an idea what's there.
So maybe you can, someone can tell me. So if you can tell me how many terabytes, gigabytes, 15,000 vinyls have, then maybe I can compete.
Less.
It's less?
It's less.
Okay,
yeah.
Then I'm out.
Yeah, I don't know if the discussion is so interesting if we tackle into if it's for 1,000, 10,000, 10 million songs. I mean, the problem is obvious. There is too much. And what's missing is this very special, very human thing, like if we always put our mood, our experience into text, like a like, a comment, an emoticon, we are missing everything. We are missing the temperature here. We are missing the awful sounding system. We are missing the taste of the veggie burger, you know? And it's still hard for machines to put these things into bits and bytes. And as long as we cannot do this, the machine will always be behind the thing which your friends can do for you or which you experience. Yeah. So for me, it's really more about the point, do we really want to work into such a direction, like digitizing our entire body reaction, which is in the labs already possible, we are working on such things, or if we say, now come on, that's too much, I'm already a little bit fed up with all the things going on at the moment, and let's stay human, and I will refuse to like tweet and Twitter all my body reactions in order to get better recommendations and replies. I think this could be an interesting direction maybe to ask the audience too.
Well, I have a different kind of way, and I think about this. I have a different way to ask this question. What can be done to, and it seems to me that there's nothing we can do to stop the forward progress of smart people like the three people around me on this problem. You guys are smart people. You come up with some of these solutions.
I can go if you
right?
want.
Right? No, I mean in terms of you and I are the moderator and I, which is why I'm not including myself, are not working on this problem, right? So we don't come from an AI background. We don't come from a mathematics background. So we're not working on those kind of problems. I mean, part of what happened in finance, I don't know if Europe was in the news lately. I don't know if anybody heard about this, but as was my home country and land of citizenship, part of what happened in finance, one of the first things people said after the financial collapse was, let's go back in time, or let's go find the person who came up with a credit default swap and fire them. And actually, if you look at the history of what happened there, there were incredibly smart people who were going to come up with this incredibly smart idea. If you stop one of them, someone else was going to come up with that incredibly smart idea. And once that smart idea was out there, it was going to spread, and people were going to try it. There's no way that we can say to Wall Street, stop doing tiny, tiny transactions unless we actually create a rule that says they can't do that. It seems like the same is true of music. Smart people who come from an AI background, aside from us smart people who come from a digging background and other things, and I do poetry, and I've studied puppetry and other fabulous liberal arts studies and improvisatory dance. But people who come from an AI background are going to work on this problem in this way, in ways that us people who do improvisatory dance may not entirely comprehend. What can you do to invest in some way, even if it's in our personal lives, in the other side of the equation? Maybe there's nothing that can be done to stop that side of things, but what can we do to do our jobs better? I'm not doing a terribly great job of knowing what's going on in parts of the music world outside Kreuzberg and Neukölln some of the time. So I would
push back on the inevitability just a little bit. So like as someone that isn't really an academic anymore, but only recently made that switch, I think it's fair to say that's not forced, right? So, and I mean, you see this a little bit in music recommendations specifically, because until, I mean, not that long ago, maybe somewhere between 5 and 8 years ago, there was this massive push towards the assumption that the best playlist was a collection of songs that was most similar amongst itself, right? And there has been this move through a few researchers that sort of raised their hand and were like, you know, there's lots of other kinds of things that people want to listen to as collections, right? Is this one better? Oh, it's much better. I can hear myself. Yeah, maybe we just shouldn't use that one. So, how many people heard that small rant that I just went on? Anybody? I'll just start from the beginning again. So I think it's the case that the sort of broad consensus of academics can be pushed, right? I don't completely accept the premise that all the AI researchers that are thinking about music are inevitably going to go this way, right? So they will make artificial systems that concern music, sure. But what will those systems do? I don't think that's inevitable, and I think that there's a role for outside influence, and especially for early researchers as well, to push in certain directions. So to not ignore the questions that are relevant, right? So if if it's the case that, that something that would be very useful would be to assist in finding the things that you can talk about, right? So if you're a music reviewer, say, helping you to find music that's better to review than others because your time is finite, right? Those are questions that could be worked on but aren't. It's not inevitable that they are ignored forever, right? It's, I mean, and the example that I was going into was just that, you know, 5-7 years ago and earlier, researchers were very concerned with making playlists that were very similar to themselves, right? So the best song to play next is the song in the whole corpus that is maximally similar by some way we can measure similarity to the song that we just played, right? Sometimes that's right, frequently that's entirely wrong, right? Frequently what you want is something that, that wanders around in some way that is controlled, right? And if you're a person constructing a playlist, maybe you're telling a story and the story has to go over this way, and so if you just stay in the same spot, you're never gonna get there. And I think that has changed a little bit, it could change more, but this is a sort of example of, and I sort of watched that change, I watched the consensus move a bit away from similarity for similarity's sake. So I don't know, I mean, I guess I don't think, because I think in finance, the goal is always to make money. And until you change the fact that the goal is to make money, then they're always going to optimize towards making more money faster, right?
I should clarify and say I'm not blaming anybody here for the financial crisis. But maybe, you know, maybe what was relevant about that story was in the end, and I mean, I think this is kind of a culturally relevant crisis in our world. In the end, what was dangerous was not the people who came up with the algorithms. It wasn't the smart quants and the mathematicians and the AI people that they recruited out of programs much like the ones that you all went to. But the real problem was the people more like us, the people who didn't understand what those algorithms did. The ignorance of what these things do is more dangerous than the people coming up with the algorithms. So the people who didn't understand what they did and where their limitations were the people who screwed up, not the people who came up with them. So, I mean, you guys had good advice for those of us who are on the human side of this.
Before we start.
Yes, but there are good news for you because a very cutting-edge research topic at the moment is that we want to design our algorithms in a way that they explain themselves to you. Why do they propose this song? Because they found a musical relation to another song, another artist, like, okay, this song contains a sample of James Brown. And if you don't know James Brown, he has been the godfather of soul and funk. And so you get an entire story where the algorithm is not just thumbs up for this one. I don't explain you how I computed the similarity. It just tells you why. So we still have a long way to go. But this is a very promising thing, because if the music providers use these algorithms, then the consumer see what the thing does and can tweak it a little bit. And not like in former times, just accept and click and be bored or not. Or, for example, with Google, you have the problem, you don't know anything how they tweak their algorithm. You know, one week they prefer to put up blog postings, and the other week it's more like the major websites, and they always say, oh, it's objective, it's an algorithm, it has weights. But who is tweaking the weights, you know? In former times it was Marissa Mayer, now she does it for Yahoo. And if you ask really for why do you tweak it in this and that way? Yeah, it's for optimizing the advertisement model, that's for sure. So we, as the good guys in research, now try to make our algorithms more verbose, and then we see what happens.
But do you really think that it works? It is so technical. And as we said in the beginning, each and every single one of us have a totally different listening behavior, you know?
Yeah, just a short notice. The good thing about this, it's hard, but you can do it, is that in the moment you see this story the algorithm has produced, you, with your personal background, can then decide if it fits to you in which way ever. So the machine has not always to guess.
Of course,
you know?
It is like, I don't know if you know the website wearehunted.com, so it is also a learning algorithm. Yeah. So this means, okay, I can click this away. It was Last.fm in the beginning as well. You can say love or hate.
Yeah.
And no, then it's...
It's the next level.
It's the next level, yeah.
There's a lot about these user interfaces, mm-hmm. and I think that's where we still have a long way to go. Currently, we have all these nice ideas, and yes, technically we can do genre estimation, music instrument recognition. Maybe at some point in time we can even identify the singers automatically. We have better and better metadata, everything. So there's a lot of technical work done, but still, as a user, it's not where we wanted it to be when we did this. Start this topic 10 years ago.
Yeah.
There's still, in terms of actual usage and in actual user interfaces, I think we need more creative ideas how to do it in the end. Technically, we can do a lot, recommendation, collaborative filtering has all these statistics, we can adapt, we can do a lot, and still we are not there.
But you thought it would be better by now.
You said we thought it would be better. So, but you thought it would be better by now than it is what you're saying.
Yes. The group in Ilmenau, for example, but others as well, looking, if I would see one competitor say who had solved everything, would be fine, but I don't see them. There's a number of groups who do great work. And it's in use, and still not that much in use, as much in use as we thought it would be.
Where is it in use, for
example? Our technology is in Aupeo, for example.
Okay, yeah. You know Aupeo? It is a mood-based service. So if you're tired or you want to chill, you get the chill-out music. If you're energetic, you get the... Is it better now?
Yes, much better.
I'm gonna put it in my hand now and I will try to leave it like this. Better? Sorry? Aupeo. It's called, and it's a mood-based listening experience. So when you're
A-U-P-E-O.
So when you want to listen to chill music, it can. Can someone from you technicians can explain it much better than me, right?
Can you ask a question?
No, but it's to you. So do you use it?
I know.
No, and why not?
Oh, because, why don't, good question actually. Because I have my own definition of chill out and actually this is a good question because this is maybe a thing we should think about where we want to go to in the future. Not all about making it, you know, fingerprinting music and stuff. Maybe it's the totally wrong direction.
So this is my leading question, right? Because sort of where I was talking about things before is that it's really important that people who are obsessed with automatically putting together music in some way or another are seeking to answer the right question. And the only way to answer the right question is to walk away from our labs and ask the people that are going to use stuff whether or not the thing that we made is at all useful. And this is really tricky, right? So because what happens is we write a little bit of software and we walk to the desk across the room from us and we go, oh, this is great for the other nerd that I work with that's obsessed with music night and day and writes a lot of software. And if we don't expand the user testing to include people who have no idea what's going on technically, then we end up in little holes. And this is sort of getting at the bubble that you were talking about earlier, right?
Yeah, but to be fair enough, a lot of groups are trying to work on this, but I mean, if you want to ask people, you have to go where the mainstream is, which means you as a small research lab have to make a contract with Facebook, with Spotify, that they allow you to put your lousy recommender into their system that everyday people can judge. And if you try to propose this, you will try it once, twice,
and then you will give up because there is a huge commercial interest in these platforms, which is not really helping us as researchers to dig deep into everyday people's wishes and needs.
For companies that produce,
they're biasing some of the results as well, right? I mean, some of what you see at Spotify is biased by the deals with the labels and things. Yeah. Unfortunate.
Yeah, but I completely agree that it's not the technical people who will use that in the end. That's the people who have no idea what's happening and are just surprised. And yes, by the way, with my nice idea of me telling the system what I would like to listen to.
Process, party usually on a Friday night,
in a family, it should do speaker recognition as well, not just speech recognition. Otherwise, you get nice concepts, misunderstandings if the last one listening to music were your parents.
Try Ruby, for instance, and also building an app in small groups.
But this is the thing what I said when we were standing there. This is when you buy something for the whole family. Girls, you know, you have a children's music.
Have
you have
a local chapter. That is what Rails Girls Berlin is.
Yeah. So where are we heading to? What shall we do?
Rails,
I mean, we have so many different.
I don't know how we could organize it, but I would be really happy to get like. Five statements from the audience, what they really find annoying about their daily digital consumption of music, just as an input and maybe to be answered.
That's a nice idea.
I just wanted to say I participated recently in a Be My App. It was a 48-hour app making contest, and my idea, which we made, was it's called These Are My Memories, and it was basically you hear a song, you have a memory from your childhood or something, you type in the memory, you go to the song, you listen to the song, you see your memory, and then you can see, like, if you put in childhood or there's a tag, you know, whatever tag you put in, you can see who else said childhood about another song. So then you go from your childhood story to someone else's childhood story, and you can basically go along this way, which I think is such an awesome idea, you know, and it's totally different than, like, the mood thing, you know, because it's all subjective, but, you know, a childhood story, a story about love, and if you're, like, if that's what you're, like, looking for, someone to relate to your emotions, like, I don't know. So you should totally take my idea and, like, let's do something, people, come on. No.
Yeah, that's actually. Hello.
Is that not working?
I can scream.
Yeah, that's also a nice idea, but I think that's not the direction where we are heading to, because we already had this in the past. You know,
See?
All this music CD compiler. Compiling things, they all had topics, you know, songs from the childhood. Your songs from your childhood are not songs from my childhood. And it's, of course, it is nice to listen to your songs as well, but this is nothing about the future. We already had this, you know, chill out CDs, dancing CDs. It is.
I think her twist is exactly right, because the matter of what is childhood, you can relate it to the birth date credentials in the login, that's fine. So the point is, if you want to make it big, you know, you need a critical mass of people who say, this idea is awesome. I'm willing to spend my free time to do this memory tagging in order to have a better music recommendation service. So I really take your idea for free, which is great, to work now with some master thesis students on it. But really the problem is with the good stuff to get beyond the critical mass. This is such a tough thing, because you have to advertise your idea. And I mean, it's not in the App Store, it's not in the Facebook app scenario, because there is too much. It's an overload of great awesomeness, idea, apps, whatever. So that it's really hard to leverage such new ideas to a level where it gets big.
I just sort of, you know, pulling back to the idea that was raised, the interesting thing there is actually using technology to do a thing that music always does, which is serve as a sort of social glue, right? So what you're doing is you're saying, this is a song, and this is what this song means to me. and then having a conversation effectively with other people about that meaning via the music. So this is like when the title of this panel, right, the future of music is social as an idea, right? So, I mean, music is social. Music has social meaning. And so I think, you know, whether or not you can build a system that blows up and hits critical mass and whatever, I do think that there's a future because of the nature of music, sort of philosophically, in systems that allow people to have social interactions around music and about music. And that's different than automatically assembling a list of 10 songs to listen to, right? Right, as sort of, you know, they're fundamentally different ideas, right? So it's...
Which I said could also be directed at bloggers and not just the... I should take some responsibility for what's going on.
I would like to ask for some additional twist that I'm missing a little bit. Can you hear me at all?
Wait.
Okay. No, it sounds better. What I'm missing a little bit is what I would call the real social twist about the music thing, because the way I usually discover music is like I look at what my friends are listening for and people I know, and Barbara is a good source, for example, and a lot of other people, they post links on Twitter, on Facebook, whatever. If I know the people, I can judge based on that myself whether I will like the music or not, what kind of music it will be, and that makes for a good way to discover actual music. The problem that we're having with this on the technological side is that I'm pretty much tied into a certain service if I'm doing that. If a friend of mine recommends something on SoundCloud, then I have to listen to that on SoundCloud. Now, SoundCloud is pretty open, but as soon as it's Spotify or RDO or something like that, then I'm all of a sudden tied into something that has a subscription tied to it, or I have to remember what it is and search somewhere else. I never do that. So I don't have a kind of accessibility for recommendations of other people across platforms. And I think, at least for me, that would do like 90% of the trick, because I got so many stuff that I get recommended that would be fine to spend all my day just listening to music.
So there are a few people working on precisely this problem. So it's usually called content resolution. There's a piece of software, a whole system called Tomahawk. Tomahawk is quite nice, but it has a ways to go. I think this is a tricky problem, but it's technical, and there are people that are trying to get around it. I mean, I think the reason why it's not already just sorted out is because we live in a world that has many countries, and many countries have many different laws, and these laws dictate licensing, right? So you know, the reason why you have, because in some ways it's worse than you describe, right? You may want to be on the same subscription service as your friend, but your friend lives in a different country, and the subscription service isn't even available, right? So, I have great faith that in some amount of time in my lifetime, this will not actually be a problem, because there will be technical ways to just deal with it. Hopefully it's, you know, closer to a couple of years and not 20, but yeah.
I was about to respond to your question. I was just thinking of this service here from Berlin, Music Player. It's basically just an aggregator of all kind of music feeds that you can share with your friends. I mean, obviously, it does not aggregate Spotify feed or something, but you get like, I don't know, YouTube or other sources you can just put into this aggregator and share. So this is basically, I think, way to do it, actually. But I mean, you want a more general solution, I guess.
Test. Yeah, so my question would be, for me, music recommendation usually works by friends. So a friend comes to me and recommends some music to me, and I think, yeah, that's great. And the more often that friend is right, the more I will listen to him, right? So why not support music recommendation between friends? So not directly recommend it from a machine, but filter it by friends first?
That's what I call collaborative filtering. Such systems have been around for a long time. Whether they work as advertised is something different. And everybody who does such a system has something in mind regarding the business models. So it's tied somewhere. And so the people who operate the system. Otherwise, of course, yes, I think there's quite something around.
Yeah, but I mean, the collaborative filtering stuff was for sure the beginning. What you are aiming at is this Facebook profile, Spotify notification thing. And the point is just, if we think for one moment about friendship in the digital world, yeah, we are talking not about friendship. We are talking about Facebook relative somehow. And at this point, and this is the answer to your question too, we have been experimenting with such algorithms by crawling our own profiles of the lab members, Facebook profiles, Spotify stuff. And then we even tried to guess who is an influencer in a friend network, which you can do by mathematics. And the first results were so disappointing. They were so disappointing. Because if you have the concept of friendship in your brain, you know, the real thing, you somehow imagine that it might be very easy to have it in a digitized way, like a super Facebook friendship with trusted features, yeah, you know? But there, I don't know how many light years we still need to get up on this stage. And because we are missing so much about this real friendship, trustfulness, mood thing, the recommendation might fail again. Because what you pick up from your three best friends depends upon the hanging out in their favorite bar, and your best friend will never tell you that he is listening in his very spare time to Britney Spears, you know? And all these things, they are so analog by heart that I wonder if we ever come to this stage. So,
just to expand on that a little teeny bit, I think that one of the problems is that fundamentally when you interact with someone over the internet in any way, the sort of the cost of someone broadcasting to the people that follow, say, on Twitter, right? So if I share a song on Twitter to the people who are my friends on Twitter, that costs me nothing. If I am hanging out with you for an evening, right? There's like three people in a room, and we're sort of, you know, going through and posturing about some songs that we've been listening to and playing things for each other and whatever. In addition to all these analog social cues that sort of dictate how that conversation happens, that are, if not impossible, certainly a generation or more away from getting into a computer. There's just the simple fact that if everyone becomes a broadcaster, it just changes the way that you think about music coming in, because it means that everyone has become a radio persona, and so they're just shoving thousands of tracks at you, right? And that's not how you that is not the same, but on the internet, as how you sit around in a room with some friends that you, or some people you even just met, like if you're you know, you're starting uni and you're sitting around in a dorm room and whatever, and you're all talking about musical taste, right? Like those are just fundamentally different things. It's not that you simply digitize that experience, right? So that is a great direction to head, but we have a ways to go, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
I guess that brings me back to my question. It seems possible that a lot of us kind of get away from these systems. And the more that we're saturated by them, the more we want to get away from them. The more people start going back to vinyl records and trying to get together in a room together and smoke some cigarettes and, you know, and listen to records again. Is there something that we can do to kind of, how can we kind of unlock more of those sorts of experiences other than turning off our computers and stepping away from them? But I mean, is it also getting more access to things like physical records? Is it solving things like these licensing rules that mean that your music isn't available everywhere, or some combination of those things? Or should we just all get together as people and turn off the machines and forget about it? I don't know.
It's certainly within the possibility of a computer to have forced constraints that slow down interaction, right? So it's not it's not the case that we all have to sort of push everything everywhere all of the time. Now, that the things that are currently popular sort of gravitate that way, but there's nothing required about that. I mean, there's a little fledgling music network that seems relevant to this line of conversation that's called This Is My Jam, that sort of pushes in that slower direction, right? You have one song, you share the one song, when you switch it, it goes away forever, right? So I think that it's well within possibility to design systems that force people to take a breath and sort of more closely resemble the pace of physical interaction, right?
Yeah, just another thought. I think people today have much more possibilities than at any time before to have access to their favorite music. And there's so much around that the question is really how can I find it, but even if I don't, there is much more than at any time before. And we have technical possibilities, and we should go away from the idea that just to have some technical system solves all the problems. It just gives us new ways to deal with the problems, and it's up to the creative people. So to you and your profession and so on, that's the creative people who then think of new ways to work with these ideas and technical possibilities. Do you agree?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, okay. I better drink more coffee and work on that, working on that problem right away. Yeah. No, I mean, it seems like there is something to be said for, and maybe that was the point I was making about these finance machines, but finding some way to operate on this kind of, this human level again, where you can fall in love with music again. That there's something about walking away from that experience. And actually, there's something that you said before we turned the microphones on, that both of you guys were saying, which is that the obligation for all of us, I think that's me, but maybe everybody in the room as well, is to avoid trying to be, I forget how you put it, to avoid trying to be algorithms. Don't try to be the, we hear all of this stuff, curation is the new, I don't know, something else, consumption, that somehow what we do is we just aggregate all this stuff and make some very simple choices. And kind of what your app was describing too is you're actually challenging us a little bit. The people who write these algorithms that sometimes we love and sometimes we hate are challenging us to actually put more thought into this stuff, spend more time on it, not just kind of make easy choices, but really dig deeper in the music that's available and all the stuff that's now accessible. It's up to us, man.
I think the general idea that people that are in the business of creative content are perhaps acting in their own best interest by not aiming to replicate things that machines can do easily, right? Which I think is what you were sort of reminding us about. And I think it's definitely the case, and we sort of talked around this a little bit, that there are some tasks that software is very good at, that's quite easy to construct systems that can do. And there are many other tasks that are next to impossible. And you know, that's where you're not going to lose your job to an algorithm, right? So, yeah, that's perhaps my...
Again, it's not the do or don't, or I can solve the problem and then it is solved. It's a combination. It's a combination of getting technology to help us do some things. Technology did help us to get more access to music. Technology did help us to make it easier to produce music. Nowadays, with a few thousand dollars, you can buy enough equipment to make somewhat decent music. Of course, a lot of people don't know how to make somehow decent music anyway, but technically it's possible. But then it needs the creativity to combine. And then we have a lot of possibilities for the future.
But this hasn't changed much from the past. In the past, everybody could have learned guitar, but only the one who was really special, he you know, he was maybe successful or not. And nowadays it's the same. It was when this Fruity Loops thing came up, you know, it was like, oh, everybody can make a techno song, but not everybody can make a special techno song. So this, for me, this somehow doesn't count.
But it changed recording, right? I mean,
Of course, yes. He said it changed recording. Yeah, but I mean, you can record everything. I also can record da-da-da-da-da. So I put it out, it's out.
So it seems like the problem was recording. The problem was that recording was not the norm. Recording was the exception. So the early history of recording was anti-democratic in a way that music had never been anti-democratic. It blocked a whole lot of people out of the process because the technology was expensive and in the hands of a very few people, and then these powerful record labels and stuff, while they made some wonderful stuff for all of us, kind of took control of it until somewhere around the 80s when the people started storming the studios again. So yeah, it seems like it was the recording that was missing. But then I guess now I forgot, well, we were going somewhere else though.
Dinner. Talking about losing control, I have one question. If we get the perfect recommending system, would that mean, like with searching on the internet today, that there's one system which all leads us to the very same songs?
I don't think there is one perfect recommender system. I don't think it exists. Right, so because that means that we all interact with music in something that is the same way, like, you know. So I represent different listeners depending on where I am in my head. Right, sometimes it is the case that I want a thing that's an automatic playlist because maybe I'm doing something else and I actually want music that is not the primary focus of what I'm doing right now that's playing in the background, and maybe I am actively trying to find new music. Maybe I'm actively trying to find, you know, some music to give as a gift for someone else, right? I mean, there are all these modes of interacting, and then that's just me personally, that's just me, and I need multiple things. And then you take a population, I don't think it's possible. I think
the perfect system would serve every user as an individual, and for this reason would lead to exactly the perfect matching songs. And since people are still somehow a little bit different, it would not end up providing always the same thing. But if it would be in place for a decade, maybe this would change a little bit the whole sociocultural system around it, and maybe people would be end up in being more similar. For example, there had been this, when Last.fm was big, a journalist was doing a journey. He was seeking for his musical twin, a guy having exactly the same listening behavior as himself. And I mean, he did it in the large. He was a heavy user. And he found this guy. It was the topmost neighbor provided by Last.fm, by algorithms. And he visited the guy. He found him in the US. And when both guys met, they suddenly recognized that they had so many similar things in their childhood, in their family, etc. And I mean, it's a little bit scary, you know, because then it ends up that we human beings are part of a statistical process, and this is really scary. And people don't like very much when I'm telling this story, and I don't like it too. But it has happened, and this is the thing with having machines processing enormous amounts of data of a digitized world, of digitized people, we will be confronted with new findings. And this won't stop.
Yeah, right. I mean, that if you're afraid of that, you're also going to be afraid of developments in human evolution and everything, too. I was thinking there was another example of this with Pandora. Tim, the kind of reverse of this. So I guess there are sometimes anomalies in these systems, right? So I remember Tim, the founder of Westergren from Pandora, said that he had this one artist who suddenly started charting on Pandora, but it was someone no one had heard of. Somehow he just had the right set of musical connections according to the algorithm that he became a like Pandora superstar. The system just kept recommending this guy over and over again. I don't know what you make of that, but I, you know, nowhere in this conversation we haven't talked about place at all, Right? I mean, it seems that, you know, a lot of the kind of current monotony of music for all the access that we have to it is because we're all very bound by the places that we're in. Maybe this kind of desire for face-to-face interaction means we go to certain places. You know, I'm in Berlin for a reason. But
I mean, Blaze is, for researchers, lame because it's geotagged data, you know? This will be big. It is already. You have geotagged Flickr photos and you can compute automatically the perfect tourist map of Berlin just by clustering all these geotags, and it's just a snip. So, I mean, Blaze is big. It will be around in the next 2 to 3 years. Emotion is bigger because of the hardware problem that you have to get it into the machine. But this comes back to my question, which we had like a couple of minutes earlier. Like, do we really want to have this in this way? Do I want?
Wait a minute. I mean, part of one issue with that though isn't the system skewed towards certain artists? I mean, it seems like if you look at what's in Spotify, for example, the amount that belongs to the maybe future Universal EMI is. Hey, I don't know. Some gamer needs to explain to me what that means. Timeout? Okay. Oh, okay. That means we should stop. What was I asking? Maybe it doesn't matter. We'll ask you over dinner.
Okay, so let's wrap it up. But actually, I have no conclusion. Do you have a conclusion out of what we talked? I understood maybe 25%. It was really fun. But I have no conclusion out of everything.
Certainly, there will be room for many more PhDs as this works.
And I mean, it's better to end with good questions than with all these silly answers that, you know, what might happen in a social digital future.
I would like text boxes to disappear in the future. That's my. I'm going to end on that. Text boxes, they just need to go away. That's it.
You don't want to live here. If you're afraid of text boxes, you do not want to move to Germany, I should say, right now.
Okay, so any questions? I mean, it was a bit confusing. Sorry for... No
questions?
One question?
I don't have a question.
Do you see a chance that ever recommendation systems will not be misused? And I mean, that's my biggest problem was Last.fm. When I stopped to use Last.fm is when they started throwing Pussycat Dolls at me. And after I banned the 10th track from Pussycat Dolls in my playlist, I thought, okay, they are bought. I don't want their music anymore. But the same thing. I mean, this is not actually a new problem and not something specific to Last.fm. It has been the same with MTV in the 80s. It's certainly the same with journalists in general as well. So all kind of recommendations. Is there a way to avoid systems being tampered too much so that they get destroyed from a user experience perspective, or is there just too much financial interest in selling records through such a system?
Who wants to answer?
Journalists probably have the most to answer. Okay. Journalists probably have the most to answer for. You know, mostly what we hope is that our rampant nepotism and bias prove interesting to all of you, you know, and that you like them. Other than that, we're the least objective, right?
So I think this is actually, I'm hesitant to actually blame the problem you describe, which certainly does. It's a thing that exists, sure, but I don't know that it's a sort of financial corruption, which seems to be almost kind of what you're teasing towards. I think the problem is averages. So here's what happens. So you joined Last.fm kind of early, right? And you're surrounded by other people who have joined Last.fm early. And so the average of all these people are sort of early adopters who have a particular kind of taste. And then Last.fm gets popular, and then the average is popular people with their crappy taste. Right, and so then Last.fm gets dragged more towards popular stuff. So I guess what will solve your problem, if it's as I think it is better statistical models, and maybe they will come. But I think you should get angry at the mean, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
And licensing. We should also point out the system is economically biased towards some artists and away from others. The myth is that bias is suddenly gone. But because it's under attack, it's defending itself. And big labels bless their hearts. We love you, Universal, and so on. I see you across the river. We are still trying to, understandably, trying to protect their business model. So part of what's happening is that the economic output of these systems is still biased toward the people who had always been at the top of the charts. So you have a nice self-fulfilling prophecy. There's music all over the world that isn't even getting uploaded to any of these systems to begin with, right? I mean...
Yeah, if you try to sell a recommender system on a product ready stage, you are always asked, where is the part where I can define my hard rules, you know? If I want to push ADSR, then please have it randomly spread in them. Yeah, I mean, that's the point. That's the business beyond our fantastic statistical models and algorithms. It's if then I bypass your algorithm because for some commercial reason.
Fully agree. I don't think you will get around it. If people get too much angry about it, it will become less. But that's the only possibility.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's it. I mean, let's close. Let's go. Yeah, you love music, we love music, and just do it, you know. Okay.
So, yeah, is this working? Yes. I would like to thank all of the participants here, and also thank actually the people who more or less introduced me to them. And yeah, very happy that you were here. Probably we could have another hour, but we will not solve the problem of the future of the music and where is it going. We could continue talking about it for hours and hours. So. I would like to say just 2-3 more things. We will continue after dinner at 8 with the Women in Tech presentations at this stage, which will be Nella Brown talking about help, we need sound. And the second one will be Becky Stewart, and she will explain us how Arduino is changing the music. And afterwards we'll change then to video, where Carsten Wortmann, he is the